o'clock, start the meeting. Can I welcome all the members and members of the public for attending this evening. This is a special environment and scrutiny committee called in order to determine its views on the future provision of golf courses in the world. There is a process we will follow. I've already introduced it. The lead signatory will be invited to speak. We normally allow 5 minutes. I'm not a person who believes in parking. You've got something to say, and it says it takes 6-7 minutes. I haven't got a problem with that. So, you know, the committee's agreement, I won't be enforcing a 5 minute rule. Is everyone okay with that? Okay. Once the lead signatory spoke, the cabinet member will be invited to come and present the case of why they think this should go forward. And we'll then call a series of witnesses. We have 4 witnesses called by Councillor Lewis and 4 witnesses called by the cabinet member. We'll hear all their views, and then we'll have a summary from the lead signatory and a summary from the cabinet member before we go into debate. So we can start by calling Councillor Ian Lewis. Sorry, being corrected. I'm looking at this. There's a Members' Code of Conduct, Declaration of Interest, the Party Whip. Anybody got any Declaration of Interest? Party Whip? No? Okay. We can then move on to the explanation of calling by the lead signatory. So I could invite Councillor Ian Lewis to come forward.
Thank you, Chair. Can everybody hear me? Okay, my name is Ian Lewis and I'm one of the 3 councillors in Wallasey. And I'd like to thank you for giving me the opportunity to address the committee this evening. Can I begin by saying that I recognise that while the decision before you this evening was taken by the new cabinet member, it would be fair to say that the bulk of the work around this particular issue and the decision itself rests with the previous cabinet and the previous cabinet member. As we know, there have been precious little meaningful pre-decision consultation about this specific issue. And we cannot take the results of the previous budget consultations about the whole council and selectively use the results to justify the actions about one service alone. It cannot be right, surely, that the consultation will only be undertaken after the negotiations are concluded, as has been outlined in the decision taken by the cabinet member. Indeed, some would argue the decision does not sit with the new leader's commitment to be open and transparent and to work with all parties for the benefit of the borough. That is why, Chair, I and others have asked for it to be reviewed this evening. So let me now go into some of the detail about the sport and this council's response to it. We know from the previous cabinet again that they accepted a report that said golf is in decline. And yet Sport England has suggested that the number of people playing golf each week now stands at 740,000, a rise of nearly 10,000 people a year. The previous cabinet, as we know, were also very keen to see a new golf resort built on land at Blakeley. And the borough will, as we know, once again be hosting the Open. That does not suggest a sport that is in decline. The witnesses we've called, and who I'm grateful for coming along tonight, are the people who are using our council-owned, council-run courses day in and day out. It would be interesting to know how closely the council has worked with them to seek improvements to the courses and how much influence they felt they have had over the service as both users and taxpayers. I'm also concerned that the council is using a report dating from 2017 that covered only one of the courses, in this case Arrowe Park, in the decision before this committee tonight, and that no assessment of the Warrens has been undertaken on a similar basis. The agronomist report by STRI quotes various figures, but as this is not assessed against any baseline or any alternative proposals, we have no guarantee that two years later, the costs and the works outlined in that report are accurate, or if they're getting worse. Indeed, the lack of reliable, accurate financial data relating to each course has been raised by this committee several times in the past. We know from other asset transfers that this council has undertaken that the council's own cost codes for services provided to individual venues were often wildly inaccurate, much to the concern of those who then took those services on. The figures before you tonight for the two courses, Arrow Park and the Warrens, suggest that not only will the running costs be reduced, but the council will also generate a lease rental from the operator, while the operator also manages to raise a profit, all from a sport the council says is in decline. Nowhere, however, in the report or in the decision does it say how these savings, income or profit will be generated. I would also be surprised if the Cabinet's preferred bidder is relying on the figures from the 2017 report to decide whether the terms as now proposed by the Council are feasible or acceptable. I would like to finish by referring to the example of Basildon Golf Club, where the Council there undertook a similar exercise to what is proposed by Labour councillors here in Wirral. Auditors subsequently criticised Basildon Borough Council for the privatisation deal it made with Jack Barker Limited, and accused cost to the Council. The Court of Appeal also ruled that the Council had acted unlawfully when it granted permission to Basildon Golf Centre to redevelop the course, even though the company continued to need taxpayer funding. Under the proposals that you have before you tonight, for these two courses in Wirral, both courses will continue to require taxpayer funding, but the taxpayer will have little say in how the money is spent or how these assets, including the historic grange at the Warrens in Wallasey, will be maintained or what its future purpose will be. Tonight, Chairman, I hope the Cabinet member in whose name this decision is now being taken will be able to answer these points and allay the very genuine concerns, not only by the course users, but by the wider community of both courses.
Thank you, Councillor Lewis. Members, does anybody have any questions of Councillor Lewis? That would like me, Councillor Lewis. Could I ask Councillor Anderson to come up and come forward?
From the committee, I would like to exercise my right to make this brief opening statement. And mainly, I'd like to cover four points highlighted by Councillor Lewis in his reasons for calling this decision. Before I get to those, Chair, I would firstly like to make it absolutely clear that my reasons for taking this decision are the principles or red lines which I considered in making it. We've got to find ways to save money. Everyone around this table this evening knows that. It's not an issue for us to debate or disagree on, but the simple fact is that we now have less money but are required to provide more services. That situation means we have three basic choices. We can close services, we can bring in more money to pay for them, or we can find new ways to deliver them. I want to protect our services, every last one, and I don't want us to have to cut our cloth to reduce services because our financial support is being reduced. I want to find ways to make our services better for local people, and I also want to protect jobs. I don't want to ever be in a position where this council is making compulsory redundancies to balance the books. They are my red lines. And the reason why I agreed with this proposal from last year is why I made this decision. To protect services, to protect jobs. Regardless of our political differences, I believe that you will all agree with those principles. Turning to the call-in notice itself, I do have a few brief points to make. The first point of reference, Blackwood Golf Course, Councillor Lewis makes the quite correct and reasonable point that Brackenwood is affected by the same issues as the other courses, but it's not included in this proposal, and so will not enjoy the benefits of it. Both those points are correct. Brackenwood, as members will know, forms part of the local plan process. The outcome of that local plan process is a decision for the full council, not me. Once it's made, Brackenwood would quickly be folded into this decision. Councillor Lewis also states that accurate financial information for the courses has not been provided. Unfortunately, this is not correct. Members of all parties took part in scrutiny review of this budget proposal last year. As part of the consultation process, and were provided with all this information. It is not included in this report, as clearly this is a commercial negotiation. However, if any member wishes to see it, they only need us. It can be provided to members, but as you'll appreciate, the usual rules regarding commerciality and sensitive information will need to be considered by the committee. Calling goes on to challenge the scope of the negotiations. Again, I will come back to the fact of this proposal that is to seek an expert operator to take over the management of our golf courses through a long lease. This was discussed at length with members of all parties through the scrutiny process last year. I will also confirm that this is not the final decision. Members will have the opportunity to scrutinise the final proposals when they come back to Cabinet later this year. The decision is simply an agreement to progress with negotiations with the supplier who's provided the strongest bid. My final point, Chair, is related to consultation. The proposal for this service was published last year as part of this Council's budget savings, and I must highlight, was not opposed by any political group on the Council at that time, and was then subject to public consultation. We got very little opposition to this proposal from residents, and the feedback we got did get back was very supportive. But I will be clear with members tonight, when we get to the point of transitioning to a new supplier to manage these services, we will make absolutely sure anyone who uses them has a full voice in informing any changes or improvements that are made. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor McManus. Do any members have questions? Christina, Tom, David.
Chair, can I just ask a question before we move on to the questions? If we could also hear some of the evidence of other officers in the room, before the Cabinet member have any questions?
The Cabinet member will have an opportunity at the end of all the evidence given to someone else.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you,
Chair. The Cabinet Member question is on what you said, please, Julie. First of all, you spoke about gravel being in the plan. I think if I remember right, and I think Chris, you were in that meeting, you were told the reason the gravel board wasn't included was because it was in the Greenbelt review, and then we pointed out that Sarah Park was also in the Greenbelt. But we did raise the point at the time that as that land is owned by the council, at any point a decision could have been made to take it out of the local plan. That's what was so wished. We then looked at what happened with the leaked information that came out just before the elections about Brame golf course being built on. And you can understand why a lot of people who use Brame golf course and who live close to Brame are very concerned. You also say that we had money from this, we had the financial information from our scrutiny committees. No, we didn't really, because we never got to the bottom of how money was collected. And you mentioned four things that were important. And I would have thought one of the most important things were, how do we save money? And how do we not spend money unwisely and lose it in other areas? Because I think that would be sensible, and I don't understand why the golf courses might have to fall because of things that are happening elsewhere. But I'm also concerned that the money that we are told is collected is not based on any fact that anybody, that most of us around that table could see, and we asked on numerous occasions. Now, I'm only saying what happened at those scrutiny meetings. I don't know whether you remember it. Were you remembering it last year? So if you were, you will understand that we asked and asked those questions. So it's not really fair to say that we have got adequate financial or the running costs, because we didn't know. We don't know the staffing costs. There were different staffing costs. So a number of questions there on what you said, Max. Okay, thank you, Councillor Muspratt. All I can say is repeat that Brackenwood is in the local plan, so it's not something that can be discussed this evening. With regards to the financial information, as I said, that can be made available, should you wish it, and that's not a problem. But equally, the witnesses I have with me tonight, one of those is maybe able to give you some more detail on the financial information. Well, as I've said, the information is commercially sensitive, but you can have the information, as I've already said, if you require it.
Thank you, Chair. I know you need to take care of it, Councillor McMahon, as well. Just wondering what consultation you've had with the specific clubs, users, have you spoken to them, and what were their views?
To be honest, Councillor Anderson, I haven't as yet. You appreciate it, you just said yourself that I'm new to post, and it's not quite a month yet. And during that process, you will appreciate that there's quite a lot of people to get to meet, including senior officers, and to get to understand your brief. Equally, as Councillor Muspratt alluded to before, I wasn't on the Environment Committee, so I've obviously had to do some homework on this particular issue before I signed, and then before we came along this evening. So, but it will be my intention to meet with people. Thank you.
I'm sure most of us may agree that the council has consultation terribly. I understand you nearly attended in a month. So why then did you sign this decision before you spoke to those clubs, those youth groups to seek their views? Why did you wait?
As I've already said, and as you've said yourself, Councillor Anderson, I've come new to this post. I think a lot of the work was already done. It's been through consultation, it's been through budget scrutiny as well as scrutiny. And so this isn't the final decision, as you know, but it is where we are at the moment.
Thank you, Chair. Well, I think we'll hear from the users tonight about what consultation this council has given to them. Just on the courses themselves, how concerned are you, or what steps are you going to put in place to ensure that the fees will remain affordable for the users of Wirral, that the courses will remain open, and that council taxpayers' money that we give over is spent appropriately?
I can assure you, Councillor Anderson, that there's a covenant being put in place that will ensure that these golf courses remain for golf, and that there will be pay and play fees that you will not be expected to sign up, an annual membership fee, for example. So I can assure you that they will be affordable.
Okay, David.
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, Councillor Madison. You'll have to bear with me because I'm not a golfer. But would it be possible, do you think, that given the testimony of Councillor Lewis, that in fact golf is still very popular in this country, and particularly on the Wirral, that there's actually been an either unintentional or intentional managed decline of the sites that we're talking about here, so that in fact they become less attractive to play golf at? And as a result, then the figures will automatically look back, and that plays very well into getting rid of them from the council. Forgive me if I'm being obtuse there, but it seems to me that when I visited Arrowe Park, knowing that I was coming to this meeting, there was an awful lot of weeds, etc., which I wouldn't have expected to see in managed courses by the council. So I think my question is, have we actually wished for something to happen, and surprise, surprise, it has.
Thank you, Councillor. They're just choosing to touch you. As far as I'm concerned, during the information that we give, that's not managed for it to go into the plan.
I'm conscious about not understanding golf, but I'm wondering just whether we have the kind of figures to hand that would give some sort of an indication of how it's gone downhill in your eyes over the last 5 years or so.
I I believe that my witnesses may have that information. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Yeah. Councillor McManus, you've spoken already about consultation. Can you confirm, please, whether staff and the relevant trade unions have already been consulted about this issue? And also, if the council do decide to transfer this work to another operator, will the staff have the opportunity to transfer to that new operator? And if so, will they get the same terms and conditions that they currently enjoy?
Thank you, Councillor Kenny. I obviously don't speak on behalf of the unions here, but I do believe that consultation has taken place. And what I would also say is that I have met with them already. I am listening to their concerns and I'll continue to do that and hope that we can, well, we'll build on that relationship that we've already just begun. This decision wasn't about making savings. And it's not designed to make our staff worse off. If anything, we want to protect them and make sure that that they are subject to duty, so that they will be able to transfer across to any new provider should they wish to do so. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I'm just a bit confused. You just said there that this decision wasn't about making savings. Yes, the open remark is that it's about saving money. So what is the decision about then?
It's not about making savings to staff, Councillor Anderson.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions for you, Councillor McManus. I'll have to word these carefully because I'm conscious I don't want to breach any exempt information. But the Grange that the ones is involved as part of this, have the tenants of the Grange been spoken to? Have they been evicted or given notice to quit?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that question then.
The Grange forms part of the report at the Warrens. Do the current tenants of the Grange, are they aware of this? Have they been given notice to quit or have they been evicted?
They haven't been noticed to quit and they're not evicted. One of my witnesses will be able to give you more detail on the consultation with Grange. Thank you.
One final question. Are you satisfied that the cost estimates are accurate?
The information I've been given, yes, I am, Councillor Blakeley. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions for Councillor McManus? Yes, Allan?
Thank you, Chair. Councillor Manners, can you tell us how many people are actually using these four golf courses on Wirral at the moment? Because they're being subsidised, aren't they? So how many people are we actually subsidising?
One of my senior officers will be able to give you the accurate figures.
Could I ask you, do you support the golf resource at Hoy Lake? If so, why do you think the golf there will be a success?
Currently, with the information I have, I do support the golf resource at Hoy Lake. However, that's not what we need to talk about tonight.
Yeah, well, I just wondered why, in your opinion, why you think it would be a success there?
I think in the past we were called the golf peninsula. And I think from my memory, I think we were always known as the Leisure Peninsula. As I say, we have further discussions to take about the golf. Don't know if golf resort is quite the right name for the Celtic Manor Resort. I'm not here to discuss that this evening. Thank you, Councillor Anderson.
From there, I have one or two further questions. When we're looking at the ones out of power that is in this report, we have to, and I hope you would accept, that the impact of transferring those courses would have an impact upon Cllr. and on Brackenwood. And we have a lot of people now who pay an invigorate which gives them, I think it's somewhere around £35, which gives them access to four courses. What guarantees would there be that those people who pay for invigorate would be given the same access?
My understanding, Councillor Blakeley, is that invigorate will continue.
Anybody have any questions, Councillor Manners? Thank you, Councillor Manners. Okay, I'd now like to call the witnesses for the Ian Lewis has asked to come forward. Can I have Patrick Hickey, Honorary Secretary of Cllr Park Golf Club? If you'd like to make a statement to us and then you can ask any questions we can do it around. Thank you.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak on behalf of Arrowe Park Golf Club. Arrowe Park has been a resident golf club at Arrowe Park course since it opened in 1932. That's some 87 years now. And obviously our members have been contributing by paying to play there all that time. Arrowe Park Golf Club hosted the final qualifying round for the Open at Royal Liverpool in 1947. And we had all the history, the competition books, etc., and the winning cards. So we're steeped in the history of golf on the Liverpool. We hold charity events throughout the year and have raised thousands of pounds for local charities such as Wirral Hospice and Cllr House. In fact, our last event was on the 1st of June and we've raised £4,000 for Cllr House. Our membership continues to grow with applications being received every month. We are a thriving golf club and I've actually got four applications this week just come in to join our park golf club. Over the last 5 years we have witnessed councils issue maintenance contracts at Boodle, Bowring, Park and Elmere Port courses, only to see these companies go bankrupt and the councils have to take back control of the courses and sort out the mess left behind at a greater expense. More recently, we have seen Allerton, Kirby and Shirley golf courses leased to specialist companies. In these cases, the company has registered a new golf club at each of these locations and the existing municipal golf clubs, Allerton, Dudley, Kirby, Shirley and Helen, have been refused right to play on the course as a club. And as such, four of these clubs have now ceased to exist. If Arrowe Park and Warren courses are leased, then three more golf clubs could also disappear. Arrowe Park, Wellington Golf Club and the Warren. We ask the council to reconsider and look to invest in the appropriate staff and machinery so they too could run our course at profit rather than give the profit opportunity to a private company. Would it not make sense to employ someone with specialist knowledge of maintaining golf courses and put them in charge of the four municipal courses rather than the council employee covering all leisure activity that is a jack of all trades and a master of none?
Which I chased for and not requested.
So that helped you.
Yeah.
And can you tell me what investment has been given in the course over the last couple of years? From the council?
As far as I'm aware, none. There's all
expand. I will say at present, Arrow Park is in very good condition, hence is why it's up for sale.
So, just to be clear, the council hasn't consulted with you also about the running costs, the income and the maintenance.
No.
Thank you.
Do you believe the council could run these clauses better than they do now, and if so, how would you do it?
Yes, I do. I mean, at the moment, the way my understanding is that the council run the course is it goes into a large melting pot with swimming pools and tennis courts and bowling greens, etc. So the money actually taken in at the courses is not put back into the courses. It goes into the melting pot, and obviously a small amount is allocated to each course to run, which is obviously insufficient for that course. That's why my comment was that if the courses were separated from the leisure and you got an appropriate expert in that understands golf and courses, etc., that they could be run at a profit. Why else would you be leasing them off to somebody else? Because that's exactly what they're going to do.
Thinking about the department as opposed to the staff on the course, do you feel that they understand the issues of the course?
No.
What do you think that could do to improve it? How do you think they could work with you to improve that situation?
Well, I think that they need to consult with the clubs. You have regular meetings on a monthly or quarterly basis, talk about works, etc., that are required on the course. We're the users, we can tell you the faults we find on the course and where there's problems on the course, but we're never invited to have meetings with the greenkeepers and the people that run it to discuss these issues and try to rectify and improve the courses.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you,
Chair.
Yeah,
Councillor
Ian Lewis. Mr. Hickey, you just said a minute or so ago, because I wrote it down, I was a bit surprised, you said Arrow Park is up for sale. Can you clarify that? Because my understanding is that the whole issue is still out for consultation, and the Cabinet are still considering the issue, and they intend to make a decision later in the year.
Well, my understanding is that an exercise is taking place to put the course up under a lease for several years. I was informed it would be at least 10, but more likely to be 99 years. And so the course is going to go into control of a private company with a covenant on it to keep it as a golf course and to have individual paying as you play. But as I've pointed out before, there's a company currently running three of the courses in Merseyside where they've actually stopped the course. The club playing on the course, registered a brand new golf club and said if you want to play, you'd be a member of our club. You can't play as a member of your club anymore.
Yeah, well, can I come back, please, Chair? I mean, I get the impression that what you're saying is that you fear that the golf course is going to be up for sale. You actually said it's up for sale now, which surprised me because my understanding is out of part. It's not up for sale.
Arrow Park is up as for a, be taken over as a lease. It's been leased. The lease is up for purchase.
Okay,
Christina.
Thank you very much, I think I
understand
the
then can claim the money back. Do they have something like that?
Yes, I am actually action in the great holder, and when I attend the course, you go into the pro shop, you have a card, they scan your card, it brings up your account, your name and everything in the details, and they register around the golf, and then I assume on the computer system that goes down as an invigorate transaction.
And can I ask, is your shop open all the time?
Oh yes, it's open at the moment in the summer from 7 in the morning till 7 in the evening.
It's just so big on the city. I was quite interested about the ball, forgive me if I got this wrong, around the covenant, that you were talking about other golf courses around Merseyside whereby the existing situation had been effectively put out of business because they registered a new golf club. I'm just slightly curious about that because the covenant then clearly doesn't protect what currently exists. It just says it must remain a golf course. It doesn't say how that golf course is managed, how it's owned, how it's perpetuated throughout the life. I'm quite fascinated if you know a bit more about that because that's quite concerning. Really.
Yeah. I'd say the courses actually concerned Allerton, Shirley Park, and Kirby. Arrow Park is a member of the Merseyside Municipal Golf Club. We're a large association. There's 17 clubs in it, and we meet every year. And obviously these clubs were part of that association. And what we've experienced, or they've experienced, is when the proprietor has come in and taken over the lease and the running of the course, he's immediately registered a new golf club. For instance, Allerton Golf Club was a resident club at Allerton, so the new owner registered Allerton Manor Golf Club. And in registering that golf club, he refused the rights of Allerton Park to play on the course as a club, and insisting that the only recognised club on the course is Allerton Manor. So Allerton Golf Club and Dudley Golf Club, which played from there, dispersed. They had nowhere to play. And if you haven't got a golf course, you can't register with the English Golf Union and play as a club.
So in effect, that's really managing the deliberate decline of the existing arrangement, isn't it?
Yeah, they have taken on their own club to run at their own way, their own cost to play a member of that club, and they do also have secondary businesses, i.e. catering, and they put restaurants in there and they make large profit on the restaurants, so the golf side is not so important. It's there as an addition, and obviously it tempts parties to come and play and eat afterwards. But the actual members of Allerton Park and the other clubs, they had a choice of either joining that club or playing as a member of public and just play, you know, as and when. But obviously if you do that, you don't get a handicap.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you very much.
Just
quickly,
was there any
interest
in the how many playing members does our club have?
We've around 120 members at our club, of which 47 of them are over 60 years of age. Okay. And it keeps them obviously very fit and healthy, playing two or three times a week. We've got several in their 80s still playing three times a week because it keeps them fit.
Do you think that with that amount of people that the club is viable, has a viability to the council?
Well, as a club, obviously we're looking to improve our membership, increase our membership. If the course is in good condition and well looked after, more people want to join. And obviously, most of our members will take invigorates, which is guaranteed money to the council whether we play or not. Because I can assure you, when we've had 6 week spells where it's been flooded and we can't play, they don't give us a refund. We've paid our fees and that's it. You know. So you've got to take into account, yes, we've got 120 members, but there's Wellington Golf Club that played at Arrow Park, they've got 40 odd members, and there's several societies that play at Arrow Park. I think there's at least six or seven. Now these are all turn up week in, week out, rain or shine, play every week. You know, whereas members of the public, they look at the weather, if it's pouring rain, oh, I'm not going, I'm not playing today. Whereas, because we have competitions, the members turn up and play unless the course is closed. If it's closed because it's unplayable, that's the only time we don't play.
I would think just to finish my point of view on in terms of the finance side of it, I think when we speak or we hear from the finance people from the council, I would say that it would probably be that we're not meeting our aspirations in terms of keeping the funding going to make it viable. And that's one of the reasons why we're looking at it now.
But as I said, the courses, I'd say especially Brackenwood and High Lake, aren't in very good condition. Yeah. Therefore, people don't want to play them. Arrow Park, in recent months, has had a lot of work done to it. It's been maintained very well, and we are getting people coming off the course, walking into the pro shop and saying, what a pleasure to play that course. It's absolutely magnificent. And we ask the question, how comes this has happened all of a sudden in the last 12 months when it's been put
curious,
up for sale under a list?
Yeah. And just, can I just finish up, sir? I just want to finish that point up, because just let's ask Mr. Hickey and Mr. Hickey, who else do you think the rule has got changed in golf courses?
I don't think it needs any more.
It's an easy one for them to
have. 32,000 people agree with him.
Excuse me, honestly. It's an easy one for the opposition on this. Clap.
You can't just clap.
I'm saying this council has lost £250 million. That's what we need to understand. That's where we need to start from. That isn't our fault. That's their fault. And their government's fault. And we can cheer as much as they like every single person in this room knows that that's a fact.
And who spent all the first place?
Absolutely.
The four courses aren't costing you £250 million
a year. I understand that, but where do you put the money? Where do we put the taxpayers' money? Do we put it in golf, or do we put it in children's or adults?
Yeah, this is the public. I'm getting far off.
Yeah, never mind, I'm winning it. That's why.
Thank you. Mr. Hickey, thanks for your interesting comments.